Hello there. Welcome to Hot Seat. Today we have a special guest for you. A man who's 90 years old, someone who's made a mark for himself as being one of the most fearsome legal luminaries of our times, and an individual who ensured that we do not get to see an emergency-like situation ever again. Shanti Bhushan, our guest today. Mr. Bhushan, you were law minister in 1977 during the Janata Party government. You were the one responsible for the 44th Amendment, which would perhaps go on to ensure that what we saw 40 years back on this very day in 1975 doesn't get repeated ever again. Are you convinced, sir, that all the moves and all the attempts that you had made then, has India really moved beyond 1975, the dark days of emergency, dead and buried forever?
Cannot get repeated. The dark days of 1975 cannot get repeated. I say this with confidence on account of the 44th Amendment that we were able to push through in 1978. It was difficult to push it through on account of the fact that it required two-thirds amendment in each house separately, while the Janata Party had more than two-thirds majority in the Lok Sabha. It did not have even one-third in the Raj Sabha. Therefore, the question was how to get the support of the Congress for these amendments when only a year back, during emergency in 1976, they had passed the 42nd Amendment, which had further weakened democracy in the country, curtailed the powers of the judiciary, and made it even more ineffective.
But tell me, Mr. Bhushan, you know, I mean, while your legal career and your political achievements have been well documented and well spoken of, the one factor which is not perhaps well known about you is the fact that your family was very, very close to Jawaharlal Nehru.
Yes, yes.
And tell me, sir, in your mind, what do you think was going on in Indira Gandhi's mind that she got convinced that she could get away back then by imposing emergency?
You see, there was a provision in the Constitution which said that fundamental rights could be suspended during emergency. Even Article 19 and 21 could be suspended during emergency. Article 19 gave the freedom of speech, fundamental right of freedom of speech, which included freedom of the press. Also, it included the right to assemble without arms and peaceably. And Article 21 included the right to liberty, not to be deprived of your freedom without adequate grounds. And you could go to the courts to have those rights enforced. But once these rights had been suspended during emergency, then you had no right to speak. The press had no right to criticize the government. You had no right even to hold meetings.
But how? That's what I'm trying to understand from you, sir. And I'm asking you this question because there are only a very few people now, perhaps in our times, who would have lived through, you know, those darker days of emergency. Why would Indira Gandhi have convinced herself that she could impose emergency and yet her political career could be bolstered?
She had no choice. After the Allahabad High Court judgment, not only setting aside her 1971 election to the Lok Sabha, but also disqualifying her.
And you were the lawyer who ultimately got that
for a period of 6 years. Now she felt, of course, what she could have done was to resign. In fact, now it has come out that she had dictated her resignation letter, but it was not signed because she realized once she resigns, even if she wins her appeal in the Supreme Court, even then, Jagjivan Ram would not let her come back. Jagjivan Ram would have been her natural successor. He would have become Prime Minister after her resignation. And he was an able man. He was a Harijan. He would have got across the board support from Harijan. And Mrs. Gandhi was rightly convinced that she had no chance of coming back. Her only chance was to stick on. Her entire cabinet chosen by her told her, you must not resign. and she therefore succumbed to the idea of not resigning. Now, after this judgment, when the Supreme Court refused to give her a clean stay order, gave her only a partial stay order as Prime Minister, not as an MP, then in that case, and Jayaprakash Narayan gave a call, namely, such a Prime Minister cannot continue and she must resign. Then Siddharth Shankar Ray convinced her that the only way to get over the situation was to impose an emergency, suspend these fundamental rights.
So according to you, it was Siddharth Shankar Ray who was, let me put it this way, the architect of the decision to impose emergency.
Yeah,
it was his brainwave.
Yes.
And he was the one who convinced Mrs.
Correct,
Gandhi that the best way to deal with
Mrs.
it was
Gandhi
to impose emergency.
Mrs. Gandhi was not a lawyer. She did not know anything about the Constitution. Somebody had to advise her, and it was Siddharth Shankar Ray who advised her this course of action.
Now, it's interesting, sir, that you say that emergency can never ever be imposed in India again.
Yes.
Yet just a few days back, L.K. Advani, the senior BJP leader, still a member of parliament, went on record suggesting that forces which could impose emergency have ended up becoming more powerful today. Do you agree with that perception?
I'm totally surprised as to why Advani has said this. Possibly the streak of being a hard-boiled politician has made him say something which has no truth in it at all.
Why do you say that?
He should know that what we amended in the Constitution, which he was opposing, he was not in favor of the 44th Amendment.
So Advaniji was not in favor of the 44th
no.
Amendment. Why? What were his reasons?
He was saying either we repeal 42nd Amendment as a whole, to which the Congress would not have agreed, or we take advantage of those draconian powers as the party in power that was.
So what you're suggesting is that L.K. Advani effectively wanted to usurp the same kind of powers that Indira Gandhi usurped in 1975.
Yes, not only him, also Ram Jethmalani, who was not a minister, but he was an important member in the parliament. He was of the same view.
Hmm.
But statesmanship consists in not looking at mere the present, to look at the future, what the nation demands, and therefore the cabinet overruled Advani.
So why do you think Advaniji would have said this today?
Well, I don't know. Probably he is very dissatisfied with his situation today. He expected that in the case of a BJP win, he would have a sure chance to become Prime Minister. He has been deprived of all that by saying 75 is the maximum age for a person in politics.
So it's interesting that you're telling us today, 40 years after emergency, you're saying that L.K. Advani, who every year on this day, on the 25th of June, writes blogs, columns and reminisces about what had happened during the emergency days, ended up making huge political capital out of that era. You're saying that L.K. Advani effectively wanted to have the same kind of powers that Indira Gandhi wanted.
Yes.
That's a correct interpretation.
Yes, absolutely.
But you know, there is the other way to look at emergency, sir, and the cult of imposition of emergency. And if I was to quote Mahatma Gandhi, he famously said that the job of a politician was not to project his own self, not
correct.
Project the individual self,
correct.
But to project an institution.
Absolutely.
Do you believe in our present-day political system? Are modern-day politicians promoting institutions, or are they just promoting their own individual selves?
By and large, they are promoting themselves. It has become a cult, namely to promote oneself.
Hmm.
Almost in all parties, this is going on. Look at Tamil Nadu, Jayalalitha, Karunanidhi, West Bengal, Mamta, Narendra Modi, all these. Of course, in Congress, this has always been there, namely the Gandhi family. Even Jawaharlal, in spite of being a thoroughbred Democrat, he also promoted family leadership.
So, but
in 57, he appointed Mrs. Gandhi as Congress president, who was nobody at
but
that
you've
time.
But you've named the BJP, you've named the AIADMK, you've named all these parties, barring the one party that you were associated with, which is the Aam Aadmi Party.
Right.
Is it not true, sir, and I often wonder about this, is it not true that Arvind Kejriwal and Narendra Modi, effectively, are two sides of the same coin?
Absolutely. Except that Narendra Modi is playing politics on a much larger canvas. Arvind Kejriwal has just a municipality, Delhi, as his field of work, where the constitution does not give him any power. All powers under the constitution in a union territory of Delhi are with the center and the lieutenant governor.
So because if Narendra Modi, for instance, is often accused of being dictatorial, of not being in a position in which he takes his team along. Same is the case with Mr. Kejriwal as well.
Absolutely.
But so does this also not show, sir, because look at the political success rate also. Does it not show that maybe people ultimately do end up investing in political brands, political individual brands?
You are right. There is some sense. Namely, now what is, there is no revolt in Mrs. Gandhi's Congress. Because of the one person rule, a revolt is not possible. That is why in BJP, revolt is not possible.
And according to you, is Indian democracy more powerful today, more vibrant than what it was in 1975?
It is, in my opinion, it is stronger than even American democracy. American democracy depends too much on money. In Indian democracy, we depend on people's support. Ultimately, it is the people's support, and therefore no party can think of harming the interest of the peoples so long as democracy is there. And by 44th Amendment, we have ensured that the democracy can never be throttled, even during any...
But I'm trying to understand from you, sir, the concept of democracy within a political party and democracy at the level of national politics and the way it plays out within our political domain. Now, we've spoken about Mr. Kejriwal, we've spoken about Mr. Modi, we've spoken about all kinds of parties. But let me put it this way. Many of your friends who I have spoken to and your critics as well who I've spoken to say that actually the problem is that Mr. Bhushan himself, Shanti Bhushan, suffers from the same problem that a Narendra Modi or a Arvind Kejriwal suffer from. That Shanti Bhushanji is only and only interested in promoting the interests of his son. And therefore he ends up pretty much taking the same position as the others.
I can only laugh at this suggestion. That's all that I can say.
Why do you laugh at this?
It's so absurd.
Why do you say it's absurd?
It's so absurd.
I'll tell you why. I'll tell you why. this perception comes up, sir.
Yes.
Whatever happened between the Aam Aadmi Party and you is now all out in the public domain. There were some representatives of the Aam Aadmi Party who publicly wrote letters accusing you of being an obstacle in a compromise that was about to be worked out between Arvind Kejriwal and your son Prashant Bhushan. Can you tell us exactly what happened? Were you opposed to any kind of a compromise?
Absolutely. A compromise which would have destroyed the Aam Aadmi Party as it destroyed it now.
But it would have positioned itself as an alternative to perhaps larger, bigger political crisis which was unfolding in the national level.
What is the use of an alternative if you just copy Mayawati's party? If you become Mayawati's party, what's the use of that alternative?
You're saying
alternative was an ideal political party to achieve what an ideal political party should achieve.
Isn't that a utopian concept?
Utopian. I believe in utopia and I think utopia is possible.
But you have to ultimately practice this utopian view that you're talking about in a real world. How are these two contradictory positions going to be worked out?
That utopian world can't be practiced in a real world. Every kind of... What did Mahatma Gandhi do? He was utopian ideas, but he practiced and showed to the rest of the world that this kind of non-violent resistance could be a basis of politics in the country.
Let me put it this way, sir. Former spokesperson of the Aam Aadmi Party, Atishi Marlina, and a whole host of other leaders who were associated with Prashant Bhushan and Yogendra Yadav accused you of creating a scenario of, apparently, according to the letters that all these leaders had written, you had threatened to walk out of the family home if they were to think in terms of making common cause with Mr. Kejriwal. Is that true? Did you really bully your son not to accept any kind of a proposal
Prashant
which is being worked out?
Prashant was being bullied by other leaders.
Not by you?
Not by me. Therefore, as a counterweight, I told him so that he could effectively resist the attempts of the other leaders to enter into a compromise which would have been totally unprincipled.
But you know, Mr. Bhushan, look at the kind of statements you made, sir. And all this is stemming from the same basic question that I raised with you about individuals being bigger than political systems, political institutions. Just before the elections, look at the kind of statements you made. I mean, you ended up contradicting your own self, where you one day you said that Kiran Bedi you thought could have made a better chief minister than Arvind Kejriwal.
Yes, I said.
Why would you make these kind of comments unless you yourself were interested in promoting a different individual brand? So here you're telling me that you believe in what Mahatma Gandhi says, but ultimately aren't you contradicting yourself?
When somebody puts a question, I answer it totally honestly, irrespective of whether it goes against my interest, my family's interest, my party's interest.
So it was your personal opinion?
Knowing
fully well that your personal opinion would have damaged the very party that you had helped up.
Because I felt it is, when you are a minister, you are holding that power in trust for the people, not in the interest of your political party. That is my belief. And my belief is, if every functionary starts acting in that way, to consult his conscience and thinks what is his duty, irrespective of how it will affect himself, his party, etc., then the country would be where it should be.
Let me just take a break at this stage. Lots of questions to be posed to Mr. Bhushan on the other side. Welcome back. We're in conversation today with Shanti Bhushan. Do you believe Mr. Kejriwal in all these days, sir? It's been just over 3-4 months since he's come into power. Do you believe that he has stuck to the commitments that he had made to the people of Delhi, or do you believe that he's
not at all?
Not at all.
Now it is very clear he never meant to stick to those commitments. It was only a trick to fool the people. He was able to effectively fool the people. But you can fool the people once. You can't fool them twice.
Why are you so bitter, sir? Are you not bitter against Mr. Kejriwal?
Yes, I am.
Is that the reason that your son is not the leader of the Aam Aadmi Party and someone else's?
He never wanted to be the leader.
This is not a Dhritarashtra syndrome that you're suffering from.
Totally absurd. Prashant never wanted to be a leader. In fact, his main forte is to function in court, where through his PILs, he has achieved so many things.
Lastly, then, let me ask you this question, sir. Since we're on the concept of dictatorial leaders and authoritarian leaders, look at what's happening today, sir. You have three cabinet ministers, two cabinet ministers and one chief minister, all of whom being accused of legal improprieties, perceptional improprieties. Here is a scenario where a man like Mr. Modi, who's just come to power, promising complete probity, transparency in public life, is now struggling to give an explanation. Do you believe Smriti Irani, who's being accused of giving fake degrees, Sushma Swaraj, who's under fire for her alleged links with Lalit Modi, and Vasundhara Raje, the Rajasthan chief minister, also being caught in a sense in Lalit Gate?
Well, so
is it time for all these three leaders to go?
So far as Vasundhara Raje is concerned, I have not applied my mind to the facts at all.
Okay.
But so far as Sushma Swaraj is concerned, I would say, if I had been the minister in her place, I would have done the same thing. Because humanity is much higher than any other thing. How was she hurting public interest if she used her influence with the British authorities to enable a travel visa to be given to Lalit Modi so that he could go to Lisbon and attend
But
to
knowing
his wife,
fully well, sir, that Lalit Modi is an individual who's an absconder from
what
India.
What is impropriety?
That there are cases against
what
him.
What is the function of a minister? To act in public interest. Which public interest was sacrificed by her?
So as long as she was acting in only public interest.
Yes.
So tomorrow, you know, the argument then also comes up, sir, that then you have the likes of Dawood Ibrahim and all these other individuals. If they say that I want some support on humanitarian ground, should the Indian government take the same position?
No, the question is, if that humanitarian ground support is going to affect the interest of the country, then position is different. But if without compromising the interests of the country, you can help a person on humanitarian grounds.
But why, sir, if a person is facing serious charges of fraudulency, of embezzlement of money, what should the minister be doing with that individual?
Worst criminal should also be helped. Supposing there is a very bad criminal and he wants to go and attend to his wife without compromising the country's interest, if you can enable him to go and tend to his wife for a couple of days, I would do it.
So you support Sushma Swaraj?
Yes,
completely.
I support Sushma Swaraj so far as this action is concerned.
And what about Smriti Irani?
You see, now I think the allegation against her is that she, in her affidavit to the Election Commission, first said BA.
Right.
In the second affidavit, she said BCom.
Right.
BCom, probably studying BCom, something like that. Now, and a false affidavit is certainly a criminal offense. But the question is, so many people say 10th is 10th class. They don't say, I have passed 10th class, which can be construed either I have studied up to 10th class or I have passed 10th class. Now, the law is that an affidavit should be treated as false if it is so clearly false. Now, if it could be construed that she had gone to the graduate class, and graduate class, therefore, she has not said, I have passed BA.
No, she did. She,
if she had said
yes,
that she had passed
BA. She mentioned BA, yes, she mentioned completed, then the degree completed.
No, course completed is one thing. But whether she had said that she had passed the examination.
In as many words.
Yes.
That she has to mention the word pass.
If she had said that she had passed BA examination, which she has not, the affidavit would be false. She could be prosecuted and sent to jail.
All right. Mr. Bhushan, you've taken on all questions from head on from us today. Thank you so much for speaking to us.